everyone. Today we're going to be learning how to make these adorable ornaments that are made out of cereal boxes, or you can use any kind of box. I used a cracker box today, and I did paint both sides. So the first thing you're going to do is you're going to need the e-packet, which will have the template in it. My e-packet always has in-depth instructions with lots of photographs. And then also, in this case, I do have a step-by-step diagram on how to do plaid. And not only did I give you templates for the ornaments, but I also gave you templates in case you want to make tags. It's just the perfect time of year when we run out of things to give or need a quick gift. This is inexpensive, quick, and easy. So as we begin today, what I want to do is show you how to make these ornaments using things like boxes that cereal comes in, or in this case, crackers comes in. So this one I really like because it had a white inside. And what I did is I came in and I base coated just a light gray in here. And now I've transferred on my design. This is going to be the candy cane design, and this is going to be the one with the text that says, "Let it snow." Now what I can do, this is probably like 140 weight cardstock, so you could also use that too. So I'm gonna just take my scissors and cut this out. Now, if you want it thicker, what you can do is cut multiple pieces out, but at the end I'm going to show you how to use two-part resin and coat it, and it will make it very hard and not nearly as flexible. But I'm also going to double these up and make it a little bit thicker. So I have two different sides which will make this a lot thicker as far as to make it a little bit more stable. But again, I will come over it at the end and show you how to use two-part resin to really thicken it up. But when I cut it, I make sure that I cut both of them together, and I'm using my very best paper scissors. If you want to, you could actually staple these or tape these together, and then they won't shift around on you, but I'm going to make sure that I hold mine very tight so that doesn't happen. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to decoupage these together, but I want to make sure that you understand that you've got to have the two colored sides on the inside, and that the white part, or the part that you've base coated with the light gray, will be on the outside edges so that it matches perfectly. And then I'm going to just, I've got matte decoupage medium here by DecoArt, and I'm just going to really quickly put it all over both of the box size. Now this is a little bit slippery because it has been already printed on. That's why we're not painting on these sides, but it will be fine. And if you need to, you can always use clothespins or something like that to hold it together. I'm just making sure I'm meeting it. And then what we're going to do is we're going to take a brayer and roll over this. So I'm going to hold my hand on here, make sure that it's lined up properly, and I'm going to just go over it, and I hold it in place, and then we'll let that dry. And I will sand the sides so it looks nice and even and smooth. So when you cut the surface, what you're gonna see is you're gonna have a lot of irregular edges. So what we're gonna do is we're gonna come in and we're gonna sand the sides. And so then what will happen is the edges will look nice and smooth. You can't see that this is two pieces of cardboard from the box put together, but it's a lot more sturdy now. And so I'm gonna go ahead and I'm gonna base coat this. And then I'll sand this one also. This will be my candy cane one. And I'm gonna sand its edges and base coat it, and I'll be back. Okay, now what I've done is I've base coated everything. I've transferred on the lines for the face so I can see it. And I've done both sides because this is gonna be reversible. I've also come in and I have an 1/8 inch hole punch, which I got at my local craft store. It's a little bit smaller than a regular hole punch. And that easily goes through these two pieces of cardboard. But what's really nice is it's just somewhat flexible now. And so it's going to hold up to our painting really easily. So I'm going to come in, and what I've done is I've taken the light gray that I base coated with, and I've mixed it with 50% Snow White. And I'm going to come in, and I'm using a flat brush that I've opened up. And so I don't know if you can see how the hairs are nice and open. It is a dampened brush, but I'm loading, and then I reload. And so I'm pouncing it very hard. But when I come over to the actual surface, I'm going to come over and I'm going to use ever so light of a touch, because I'm just trying to create some texture on his face. I'm going to just go over where those lines are. I put the lines on with my IdentiPen so that I'd be able to see them through it. So you can see that it's a little bit lighter and it has just a little bit of texture in it. Then I'm going to put out Solid Snow White, and that's by DecoArt. And I'm going to come in and I'm going to highlight the face. And I'm loading my brush the same way, loading it, offloading it. And it's just in this old brush, and I'm going to come in very lightly in more of the areas that would naturally be more highlighted. Okay, then I'm going to flip it over and do the exact same thing on the other side, and I'll be back. Okay, I'm going to work on the hat a little bit while my face is drying, and I've got one of my Monza Rounds, which comes from my Creative Blending set for dry brushing, and we're going to dry brush the first highlight to the hat. So what I do is I load my brush with the paint, and then I come over to where there's dry paper towel, and I make sure that there's only a residue left in the brush. And then I'm going to come in and put in a little bit of a highlight. I'm going to go back and forth, and it's going to get wider, and sometimes you'll run out of paint by the time you're done, because we are only using a residue of paint, so I can always reload. I'll start up here this time, and I go all the way up to the top. Now I'm not going to do a lot of shading and highlighting on this because it's just an ornament and I've got some text coming in, but I'm going to come in just a little bit thicker and just let it fade away. And then I'm going to put my brush off to the side in a damp paper towel. And I'm going to take the same color, our first highlight color, and I'm using a number 3 round, and I'm simply going to go along the whole outer edge with this color. Let's take some of our lamp black to shade it. And when I'm going to shade, I'm going to use a technique called floating. If you do not know how to float, let me show you really quick. But I will tell you that I do have a very in-depth video on my YouTube channel, so you can watch that, all about how to float. So I'm taking a flat brush. This is just a Tacklin flat brush. And I load the corner of my brush. So that's another term for floating, is side loading. And then I work it into my brush until there's a gradation. Then when I come over here, I can walk this out. And obviously the top part's going to be a little bit wider than the bottom part. When I come over on the right side, it will be a narrow float. And then I'll just come right behind the hat band with a nice narrow shade. Okay, so now I'm going to come in right behind here, where we initially put in the light color, and I'm just shading right behind there to really separate those two. So I wanted to show you that you can also come in and dry brush instead of walking out a float. So I'm loading my brush in the same manner with the lamp black. And then what I'm going to do is just simply walk out this paint. And I have to take my time. I'm using a circular motion. But then as the paint dissipates, make sure you don't turn your brush around. And it will just be like you've walked out the float. Okay, we're gonna come in and we're going to dry brush the red hat. I have the first highlight mixture. It's listed in your instructions. What I do is I wait until I have hardly any paint in my brush, and then I go along the outside edges, and that's where I can create the gradation of color so that it would be very similar to floating. And I'll do the same thing on the other side. I'm going to take a number three round and just pull the edge with this color. And this is the edge of the hatband. Now, if you'd like this highlight a little bit brighter, what you can do is you can dampen it. It's got to be dry first. And then you can go in with that same mixture. I'm not using a different color. But I'm going to just simply do a little zigzag back-to-back float, and it's going to make the hat look a little shiny. This works great on ribbon, too. I'm going to bring in the first shake color for the hat. And you always have to make sure you shake your paints really well, especially when you're going to be dry brushing. So I want to show you first how I dry brush to begin with. So you can either begin with your floats or begin with your dry brush, it doesn't matter. But whenever you're going to cover a wide area, it really helps to have the dry brush down, because then it will help you get a better coverage without getting a lot of streaking. Now do the other side right away. So now what I want to show you, let me pick up some of the, because I purposely left a really heavy edge over here so I could show you how, what happens and how easily it is to fix it. I'm loading my brush, and it's the brush I just used to shade with, so I'm loading it multiple times with the base coat color. And what I can do is just kind of go in lightly and soften that edge. So now that hard edge is all gone, and I'll do the same thing over here. So there's many times I'll go back and forth. I'll take my mid-tone color to soften a highlight. Now what I'm doing is I'm going to go back, now that I have mid-tone in there, and I'm going to put the highlight color back in. And I'm going to just very, very softly faded away. So now what I'm going to do is I'm going to take the shea color that I initially dry brushed with, and we're going to go over it with a float. And what you'll find is when you dry brush and float together, it just makes you look like you're an amazing floater. And this is all techniques that you can use for shading. And we're going to shade this side right away, and I just flip my brush over. And while that's setting up, I'll load my brush so that we can go right behind that hat band. Then I'm going to come in with a very, very narrow float and come right behind the striped area. Then I'm going to come in and I'm going to be using the Vintage Pink. And we're going to put in some rosy cheeks, and I'll be dry brushing those. And I'll move into a smaller brush. So I'm going to load my brush in the same manner where I load it and take out a lot of the paint, so there's only a residue left. And you always want to make sure you find dry areas of your paper towel. If you pick up moisture, chances are you're going to dig holes when you dry brush. So I also come in and I use ever so light of a touch, because even though it looked this is even lighter than the highlight that was on the hat, you can see that it can come in really bright over here. Now before I put anything else on the face, what I want to do is I want to come in and put some eyelashes on him. And I have them coming down here. What really helps is when you just start pulling them very lightly off the side of his pupil. And I'll do the same thing over here. And I use ever so light of a touch to get these eyelashes in. But it really helps to start off on the pupil and then pull them out. I'll pull his eyebrows at the same time. I'm gonna use my liner brush to pull in his mouth. Now if you don't want eyelashes on your snowman, that's fine. I like eyelashes on my snowman. I think it makes him look cuter. Also going to touch up his eyebrows a little bit. I'm going to come in and shade underneath the hat band using the same color. Then I'm going to shade above it. So let's go in with the light blue color for the eyes and just put in, this is going to indicate he has a little iris. Keep that float nice and soft, and then we'll just do the same thing on this side. I just flipped my brush over and so my float got a little bit wide. But I was able to push it back. So let's shade the nose a little bit. I have the first shade color for the nose here. You have to make sure you load this very narrowly. I'm going to go along the top too. So now I'm going to take some soft white. And I'm going to put a very, very small dot indicating there's a glint right there. Don't let these get too big. I'll also come in and pull a few lines over here as highlights. I'm going to come in with the Snow White. And I'm going to just highlight the lip right here. And I'm going to come in with one last shade to the nose. We'll brighten it up a little bit, make it look a little bit more rosy. And that only goes along the bottom. Then I did lose my line, and I didn't mean to lose my line. So I'm going to come back and, again, if you're going to use your Identa pen, make sure that the paint is completely dry. Otherwise, you'll ruin your, you will ruin your Identa pen. I'm going to just come in with my liner brush. Put the line back in for his mouth. I'm going to use a little number two. And this is a little number two round. And I have mistletoe green. And I'm going to create a plaid. And I don't know if you can see how I've penciled in the plaid. I'll set it down so I can see really well. And I'm going to just come in. Now this may turn a little brown. I did thin it a little bit, but that's okay because I wanted it to look a little bit darker. I used the brighter green just so it would appear to be green. Make sure you blot your brush so you don't have too much water in your brush. And I'm just pulling down the straight lines right now. Now I'll turn the brush sideways and I'm going to pull it right down the center. I wanted him to have a Christmas plaid. So now I want to transfer on the lettering up to the upper part. What I did is I took a chalk pencil and I just simply go over the entire background of my pattern. With some chalk. And you can use a stylus to transfer it. Now there's thick and thin lines. So on the thick lines, I will go outside the edges. I take my time with this. So I've got my fingers in place so you can see that it is showing up really well. So I've transferred it on with the chalk pencil, but then what I'm going to do is I'm going to very carefully get rid of any excess lines because we're going to have to spray this, and I'm going to first use my kneaded eraser. I'm also going to press down and soften the lines. And sometimes that's all you need to do is just press up and down. Now, if I can't get rid of something, what I could do is go around it with a little bit of water. I'm trying really hard not to do that. I think what I've got looks pretty good now. It looks a little intensified with the camera. So now I have, everyone calls this a chalk pencil, but it's really a charcoal white by General. And what I'm going to do is simply go over my lines, and I go over the outer lines first. I can do any adjusting I need. To make this look nice and neat. And as I'm doing this, I will continue sharpening my pencil because I want to make sure I have a nice sharp point on it. My favorite pencil sharpener is by Faber-Castell, and it just opens up like this and has a variety of holes so you can have different size pencils. So now what I'm going to do is I'm going to go in and I'm going to fill in the thicker areas. And like I said, if you don't like what you see, you can always just wipe it off. This is so forgiving. I love doing lettering like this. And what I want you to notice, you don't need to use chalk paint in order to do this. This is being done on regular acrylic. And you saw how we highlighted it, the hat. So I'm going to just come over here and make a few snowflakes. Put a little snowflake over here. Okay, I'm liking that really, really well. And I'm going to brighten up the highlight over here for the rim, but then I'm going to just soften it with my finger so it looks like it's been painted. Now I'm going to come in and I want to finish the plaid, so I'm going to use my liner brush, and I'm using the same color that I based in the nose. So these are such small lines. I want to make sure, oops, somehow I got off a little bit. I'm just going right down the center of these with the golden color, and then I'm going to come down the center here, but then I'm going to pull another one here and another one here. Can you see how thin that line is? Very, very, very important that you just use a ever so light touch. Okay, then I'm also going to go in. You can use a liner brush, you can use the Adenta pen. Let me show you how to use the Adenta pen. We're going to just outline his nose, and I'm using a very soft touch. And I'll also put in the bottom of his mouth. And before I spray it, I want to make sure, now I am working with the chalk is not set. I have not sprayed it, and I've noticed that I did smear it a little bit, so you have to be careful when you do this. But I don't want to spray it quite yet, so I'm going to just take a little bit of water and clean up where I touched it. But what I want to do is I want to put a little bit of highlight and a little bit of shade on the hat by the hat band. So we're going to just glaze to darken this up, and we'll walk it out. And I also want to go underneath that hat band. I've got a little bit of Snow White in my brush, and I'm going to just come in and do a little back-to-back float right where the brightest and lightest area would be. Okay, he's looking really cute. Now for this guy, I decided I wanted to put some more. I love the whole red and white effects. So what I wanted to do is put some more snowflakes on him. But since we're working a lot with paper, I thought it would be fun to use some paper punches. So I have some 40 weight paper, and I'm taking glamour dust, and I'm going to just go over the entire thing along the corners with glamour dust paint, and it's the crystal, ice crystal. We're going to let that dry, and then we're going to create some snowflakes. I have two different half-inch snowflake punches, and I'm going to use them both. And I'm going to, now that this is dried, I'm going to just go ahead and punch out a variety of snowflakes. And then I'll be able to decoupage these onto the snowman. And they'll be all sparkly. Okay, that should be more than enough. So I'm not sure if you can see how one side has glitter and the other one is matte. So make sure you're gonna be decoupaging the one with the glittery side on and just decide how you want to put these on here. I also have the 1-inch size and I want to make a big one also. So I'm going to make sure that I have all of the sparkly side up. If you need to put more sparkles on it, you can. And I'm going to decoupage them on with the same matte decoupage, but I'm putting it on the underneath side so that the upper side does not lose its sparkle. So I'm going to just put a little bit of the decoupage medium where I want the snowflakes to go. I'll put this one on here first. I'll leave that little bit go off to the side because we are going to come over with some of the two-part resin and that will harden it. Then I'm going to use my stylus and I'm just going to add a few more snowflake dots around the hat. I want him to be super snowy. So I wanted to show you that when you use the snowflake punch, you can actually create like a stencil. So I thought it might be fun to very carefully just line in some chalk snowflakes and to use this as a stencil. Now you have to be careful when you're doing multiple ones because remember, chalk can easily get messed up. But what I like about the chalk is it stays so nice and soft. So now, I don't necessarily like some of those lines, so what I can do is add a few more. And that's what I love about the chalking technique is it's just so forgiving. And then I'll go ahead and I'll do a few more. I also want to, just like on the other, on the red one, I'll put a few just loose snowflakes, and maybe we'll do 3 of these. But I want to make sure I keep them out of the way of one another. So I'll finish these and I'll be right back. So these are all done and I wanted to show you that the other side with the stencil, isn't it cute? And so now because I've sprayed it with a workable fixative, it's not, the chalk is not going to come off. It's really important that you've gotten some nice coats down because we're going to use two-part resin now and the two-part resin will probably lift the chalk if you don't have it sprayed and sealed. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to come in and I'm going to mark, 7.5 and then I'm going to mark 15. Because what we have to do is use exact amounts. And can you see what I'm doing by marking it? What happens when you put the two-part resin in? As soon as you put the resin in, you can't see these marks anymore. So I'm just, and this is just medicine cups that you can get in craft stores. And so I'm just marking them so I know exactly how much is going to be exactly half and half. And it doesn't matter if you start with the hardening or with the resin. I will say that I do keep it away from my face as much as possible. And I wear safety glasses. You could, those new shields that they have that are for COVID, they're also wonderful to use when you're using this. This will irritate your eyes. And it's also not good to breathe in. So I'm adding this slowly, as you can see, and I've hit that first mark of 7.5. Now I'm going to take the other one and bring it to 15, so I know that I have exactly half and half. I will tell you, though, that this time of year, you have to make sure your house is 72 degrees or higher in order for this to set. So the fact that it's winter, I know we don't keep our house that warm, but we will today. So now I'm going to use a craft stick, and I'm going to mix this for exactly 2 minutes. And I scrape the sides, I go back and forth. It's going to create all kinds of bubbles, but you don't have to worry about that. As soon as you heat it up, either with your hot breath or with a heat tool gun, it will dissipate the bubbles. But what's really nice about the two-part resin is it dries so hard, it's going to make these seem like they're made out of wood, or at least a hardened plastic, while they're made out of cereal boxes, or in this case, cracker boxes. Another thing I wanted to show you is on the other side, I had this snowflake meet the other one so that they will both be at the same place, because I didn't want one sticking out over on this side. So it's just a little bit different on the other side. And also you have to make sure that you have your holes and your ornaments at this point. Otherwise, you won't be able to punch through it once this is on. So what I'm going to do is just very carefully use my craft stick. And I do want to put some rhinestones on this red and white one, but I will wait until after this all hardens. And you can use a brush to move it around, but you'll ruin your brush with the resin. So I just use a craft stick to move it around. I make sure that I don't allow that hole to fill up, and if it does fill, I'm going to use something to put through it, because otherwise we won't be able to put our string through it to hang these up. And then what I'm going to do is I'm going to let this harden overnight. I'm only going to do one side. And then once it hardens overnight, I can do the other side. Or if it's hard enough, I can just come in with a really heavy-duty gloss varnish on the other side. I just want to make sure that this is not going to bend at all, and I want it to appear like it's made out of wood. I don't want people to know that we made it from our cereal boxes. So if I have extra, what I can do now is just scrape it off, because we don't have to have too much on here. I just want to make sure that it's coated really nice and that it's all around. And you have to make sure you lay this in an area that's level. Now, I would generally have gloves on. I didn't put them on. So as soon as I'm done, I will use some hot water and some soap to get this off. And if it doesn't come off, what I do is I use like an oil-based cleaner, like Murphy's oil soap will take it off. Okay. And then I'm going to apply it on the other one. And I will use my stylus to make sure that I'm getting it out of the hole. Okay, so that's looking really good. And what I'm going to do is I'm going to put this on something that's completely flat. I'll probably put it on my floor because my floor is fairly level. I know my painting table is not. Also, you can see we have a lot of resin left over. So if I were going to do this again, I would not put that much in. I'd probably mark 5 and 5 because that's really the least amount that you can do. But then always make sure that you're doing multiple projects so that you can use these, use it all up, because now this is just going to be wasted. But I do have some jewelry I can pour this in. So all is good. So now that we're done painting it and I've put the resin on and it's cured, you can see how nice and hard it is. It's not going to bend it at all. And I love the look it gives it. You would never know that this is made from cardboard. Now on the other side, I wanted to show you that I did just do the liquid glass. It would not, if you just do the liquid glass, it would just not be as strong as using the two-part resin. And that's why if I were going to use the liquid glass, I would make sure I used 3 instead of 2 layers of cardboard from the boxes. And these are going to just look so cute on the Christmas tree. The other thing I wanted to show you too is when I did this, can you see how some of the paper got transparent? When I, in the instructions, I tell you, you need to seal this with your workable fixative before you add the resin. So mine is going to have a little bit of transparency to it, but I'm going to add the rhinestones and add other things, and it will be just fine. Thank you so much for joining me today. Please give me a like and so that I know that you've enjoyed this video, and I hope you will subscribe. And until the next video, have a wonderful, wonderful holiday season, and may painting always bring you joy.